Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Mind of a Bee by Lars Chittka. Narrated by Michael Butler Murray. 1. Introduction. Let us suppose that an inhabitant of Venus or Mars were to contemplate us from the height of a mountain and watch the little black specks that we form in space as we come and go in the streets and squares of our towns. All he could do, like ourselves, when we gaze at the hive, would be to take note of some facts that seem very surprising, and from these facts to deduce conclusions, probably no less erroneous, no less uncertain, than those that we choose to form concerning the bee. "Whither do they tend, and what is it they do?" he would ask, after years and centuries of patient watching. "What is the aim of their life, or its pivot? I can see nothing that governs their actions. The little things that one day they appear to collect and build up, the next they destroy and scatter. They come and they go, they meet and disperse. But one knows not what it is they seek." Maurice Maeterlinck, 1901. Understanding the minds of alien life forms is not easy. But if you relish the challenge, you don't have to travel to outer space to find it. Alien minds are right here, all around you. You won't necessarily find them in large-brained mammals, whose psychology is sometimes studied for the sole purpose of finding humanness in slightly modified form. With insects, such as bees, there is no such temptation. Neither the societies of bees nor their individual psychology are remotely like those of humans. Indeed, their perceptual world is so distinct from ours, governed by completely different sense organs, and their lives are ruled by such different priorities, that they might be accurately regarded as aliens from inner space. Insect societies may look to us like smoothly oiled machines in which the individual plays the part of a mindless cog, but a superficial alien observer might come to the same conclusion about a human society. Over the course of this book, it will be my goal to convince you that each individual bee has a mind, that it has an awareness of the world around it, and of its own knowledge, including autobiographical memories, an appreciation of the outcomes of its own actions, and the capacity for basic emotions and intelligence, key ingredients of a mind. And these minds are supported by beautifully elaborate brains. As we will discuss, insect brains are anything but simple. Compared to a human brain with its 86 billion nerve cells, a bee's brain may have only about 1 million, but each one of these cells has a finely branched structure that in complexity may resemble a full-grown oak tree. Each nerve cell can make connections with 10,000 other ones. Hence, there may be more than 1 billion such connection points in a bee brain, and each of these connections is at least potentially plastic, alterable by individual experience. These elegantly miniaturized brains are much more than input-output devices. They are biological prediction machines, exploring possibilities, and they are spontaneously active in the absence of any stimulation, even during the night. What it's like to be a bee. To explore what might be inside the mind of a bee, it is helpful to take a first-person bee perspective and consider which aspects of the world would matter to you and how. I invite you to picture what it's like to be a bee. To start, imagine you have an exoskeleton, like a knight's armor. However, there isn't any skin underneath. Your muscles are directly attached to the armor. You're all hard shell, soft core. You also have an inbuilt chemical weapon, designed as an injection needle that can kill any animal your size, and be extremely painful to animals 1,000 times your size. But using it may be the last thing you do, since it can kill you too. Now imagine what the world looks like from inside the cockpit of a bee. You have 300-degree vision, and your eyes process information faster than any humans. All your nutrition comes from flowers, each of which provides only a tiny meal, so you often have to travel many miles to and between flowers. And you're up against the thousands of competitors to harvest the goodies. The range of colors you can see is broader than a human's and includes ultraviolet light, as well as sensitivity for the direction in which light waves oscillate. You have sensory superpowers, such as a magnetic compass. You have protrusions on your head, as long as an arm, which can taste, smell, hear, and sense electric fields. And you can fly. Given all this, what's in your mind? The challenges of being a forager in the wild. What is in an animal's, including a human's, mind is a mixture of information from its evolutionary history. Information passing through sensory filters it has acquired during evolution. Information it has memorized from its experience, and things it might imagine or anticipate. To explore the possible contents of a mind, it helps to think about what matters to the animal in question, what's important in that animal's daily life. For example, one thing you can be fairly sure is not on a honeybee worker's mind is sex. Worker bees are typically sterile, and female reproduction is ceded to the queen. On the other hand, flowers are likely to have a completely different significance in the mind of a bee than in our minds, because plants can turn solar power into an energy drink, nectar. They mean survival for the individual bee and its family. Pollen, plant's sperm, is an equally important resource to collect, since it contains high concentrations of nutritious proteins. To explore further what plausibly could be on the mind of a creature for whom flowers mean life, imagine a young bee on its first day outside its home. The challenge is to memorize the location of home and landmarks in its surroundings, and to locate profitable flower resources. Moreover, within just a few excursions, the bee would be expected to bring home a surplus, or its young siblings will starve to death. It's clear that our exploring bee must have a large archive of evolutionary knowledge. It does not have to learn to fly, for example. And it has an inborn knowledge that colored, scented dots in the landscape might be flowers. However, there are many forms of information for which evolution will not have provided the bee with the necessary guidance, since a lot is unpredictable from one generation to the next. The bee does not know from birth where the flowers are, or what exactly they look like, how to manipulate them, whether they contain nectar or pollen, whether they are a good resource or poor. Even if they are of good species, they may have already been depleted by competitors. All these things need to be explored and learned by each individual bee. In other words, a bee has to learn a lot in its short adult lifetime of perhaps 3 weeks, or it will neither find its way home nor become an efficient flower forager. A bee's first flight is the most dangerous. In bumblebees, up to 10% of foragers never return to their native colonies after departing for the first time. Some fail the challenge of accurately remembering the home location. Others fall victim to insectivorous birds or sit-and-wait flower predators, such as crab spiders. To appreciate the nature of the challenge, imagine human children in this situation. To roughly match the endowment of a few days old novice forager bee, let's assume our experimental children are already a few years old, say 6 years, so of school age. You release them into a wild environment, that is, one without purpose-built, memorable landmarks, such as buildings. Let's make things simpler for the children and keep our environment predator-free. Their only instruction is to bring back food that, like a bee's food, is perhaps up to 5 kilometers away from home. They need to have the forethought to take sufficient provisions to survive the trip, and when they run out, the resourcefulness to find their own. To match the complexity of floral structures, let's assume that the food needs to be extracted from a variety of puzzle boxes, whose mechanics must be figured out by the children themselves, without any instructions from adults. Then, without the assistance of well-meaning passers-by, they must find their way home. How many do you think you would see at the end of the day who would also be carrying a significant surplus of food? It is clear that those few who might succeed would be the ones with extraordinary spatial memory, good searching and motor learning abilities, and fine judgments of the quality of various resources. Over the next few days, some individuals may get better and better. Having remembered the most profitable vending machines, they will focus on exploiting these and recognizing others like them, and will also find shorter paths to connect the best locations. But things won't be entirely stable. Let's introduce some competition from a different group of children, and also some unpredictable changes, as in the flower world. A previously profitable location vanishes, and new ones emerge, requiring further exploration. These are just a few of the basic challenges that a bee faces, and that therefore might occupy her mind. In the following sections, we will learn that these challenges require many forms of complicated decision-making and efficient memory organization. The mind of a shopper in the flower supermarket. Flowers are, essentially, plants' sex organs, and their colors, patterns, and scents are designed to lure animals into a sexual transaction that many plants, given their lack of mobility, cannot accomplish without help. The transfer of pollen from male flower parts to female ones. But bees don't usually provide this service for free. They need to be rewarded for their efforts. From this perspective, pollination systems may be viewed as biological markets in which animals choose between brands, flower species, on the basis of their quality, sugar content of nectar, for example, and plants compete for customers, pollinators. Bees learn the advertisements that flowers display and link them to the quality of the product each flower contains. The offerings of this market are constantly in flux. A flower patch that was rewarding in the morning may cease to yield nectar by lunchtime, or may have been depleted by competitors. It may be rewarding again at the same time the next morning, but then have withered altogether 3 days later. Foraging bees need to update their information in light of these changes and juggle exploitation with prospecting for alternative sources. Much of the workings of the bee's mind can be understood only when one considers the natural challenges of the constantly changing market economy in which it must operate. The pressures of operating in this setting are often expressed in terms of physical performance. For example, a bee can carry its own body weight in nectar and/or pollen. It may need to visit 1,000 flowers and fly 10 kilometers to fill its honey stomach only once. And 100 such trips may be required to generate a teaspoon of honey. Less appreciated are the mental efforts required along the way. In visiting 1,000 flowers, the bee has to work 1,000 floral puzzle boxes, whose mechanics can be as complicated as operating a lock. And no two flower species are quite alike in the mechanics that have to be learned to gain access to their contents. While flying through a flower meadow, the bee is constantly bombarded with stimuli, color patterns, scent mixtures, electric fields, from multiple flowers of several species per second, requiring the bee to pay attention only to the most relevant stimuli and to suppress the rest. Between visits to 1,000 flowers, the bee may have to reject 5,000 other flowers that either are unfamiliar or have been found to be poorly rewarding, or only rewarding at a different time of day. While foraging, the bee also has to overcome the frustration and the starvation risk of finding dozens of empty flowers in a row that a competitor has recently emptied. And she must decide when to cut her losses and explore for an alternative food source As she keeps visiting several thousands of flowers a day, rules begin to emerge. For example, are bilaterally symmetrical flower species, such as snapdragons, more rewarding than radically symmetrical ones, such as daisies, irrespective of species and color? Learning rules is not typically regarded as within the reach of an insect mind. But as we will soon discover, the pressures of operating in the flower supermarket have given rise to such intelligent operations in the bee. What's more, while figuring out all these contingencies, she also has to dodge attacks from predators and remember and avoid flower patches where predation risk is especially high. She has to keep track of the location of her home, no matter how convoluted her flight path, and in the face of wind gusts that might displace her far from her established route. Complex decisions, communication, and construction at home. Finally, upon her return home, the bee might find that a bear is digging up her nest. What to do? Should she first unload her forage, or attack the bear and risk being killed? Should she buzz around the bear's head in a menacing way in the hope that this will suffice as a deterrent? Or should she shyly wait on a nearby tree until the attack is over? You might think that these choices are decided by innate priorities, but individual bees can choose differently according to their own predispositions. After the bear is gone, nest repairs are needed in addition to replacing stolen honey. Building honeycomb requires the construction of precisely hexagonal cells from slivers of soft material that emerge from the abdomen, the cells sized roughly to fit around a bee's body. For unknown reasons, this task involves forming hanging chains of bee workers. Bees have to hold hands with their sisters, suspended in midair, while repair work continues around the clock. Night or day, it is always dark in a typical Western honeybee's nest, one undamaged by a bear, that is. And the world inside is no less fascinating and strange than a bee's outside world. Imagine a 100-story windowless skyscraper, as packed with people as a bus during rush hour. All main surfaces are vertical, and individuals are constantly scurrying up and down walls. How does any individual know what to do among the dozens of tasks that need to be taken care of by the colony as a whole? Much of bee communication works by pheromones, cocktails of chemicals, released by multiple glands distributed over the body, 15 in the case of the honeybee, and by electrostatic signals bees can generate, which they sense with mechanosensory hairs. But honeybees can also communicate about flower locations using symbolic movements, a strange motor display called the dance language. A forager performs a solo dance on a vertical wall. Imagining you are a bee, you and several other bees try to decipher from the dancer's moves where she found a food bonanza. It's dark, so to read her movements, you have to touch her throughout her dance. A bee does this by putting its feelers on the dancer's abdomen and holding them there while the dancer turns and shimmies. To add an evolutionary perspective, imagine your life depended on how well you could sense and interpret the dancer's movements. Some of us would do better in a dark dance floor than others. Some would fail altogether. Some individuals might have a knack for communicating via dances in the dark and be pretty good at it right away. Others would be more adept at learning to communicate this way. In time, over many generations, there would be selection both for particularly efficient ways of encoding messages in dances and for aptitude in tactily deciphering the code. Why imagining other minds is important for understanding them. Some philosophers may argue that there is no point in trying to imagine such strange alternative worlds. I disagree. I think that it's tremendously useful. I cannot precisely imagine what it's like to be you, much less any other animal. But I can do it a little bit, knowing you. I cannot imagine whether you see red the same way I do. but I can check the extent to which you and I agree on calling the same things red, and the extent to which we each discriminate between two similar shades of red, which a bee cannot do. I can also imagine what it's like to have reduced sensory powers. It happens when I take off my glasses, or when I am feeling my way around a dark cellar and have to use my tactile sense to compensate for the lack of vision. And I can imagine, a little bit, what it's like to have a sensory superpower, such as X-ray vision. If I did, it would certainly be accessible to experimentation. For example, you could measure how thick a wall my vision can penetrate, whether I could detect the color of someone's clothes through a wall, and so on. Such tests of what another being can perceive help us to imagine its world a little better. The question that so puzzles some philosophers, is it unknowable what it's actually like to be some other animal, is probably relatively pointless. After all, it feels entirely unspectacular to live in an alternative sensory world, once you get used to it. Only the transition of acquiring a new sensory ability, if we could do so, would feel exciting. But it would lose its strangeness quite quickly, and then it would feel normal. Sensory perceptions only become subjective experiences in any meaningful sense if they are attached to emotional experiences. In a bee's case, perhaps, her reactions to finding a food bonanza, escaping a crab spider attack, or seeing her nest ripped apart by a large mammal. We will learn that bees have mind states that, by the same criteria applied to domestic and wild animals, would certainly qualify as emotion-like states. To explore what it might feel like to experience life from any animal's perspective, understanding what is important for that animal, as we have just done, is a necessary starting point. If we grasp that animals, such as bees, perceive the world through entirely different sensors than ours, and that different aspects of the environment are relevant for their well-being and survival, then we can unleash our imagination, immunized against the risks of anthropomorphizing, inappropriately reading human-like psychology into animals' behavior. Which bees? When contemplating bees, most of us think of social species, most prominently the domesticated western honeybee, Apis mellifera. Indeed, much of what we know about the psychology of bees has been studied in this ubiquitous species, and a handful of other social species, such as bumblebees. Their social lives come with fascinating aspects of psychology. For example, they employ highly complex communication systems that ensure the efficient division of labor inside the colony to provide adequate nutrition, climate control, and colony defense. Yet only a few hundred of the world's 20,000-plus bee species are social, and the biology and behavior of the many solitary species are no less fascinating. These bees, too, provide for their young and build a home for them. But they are single working mothers, for their males, just like those of social bees, are good only for sex. Solitary females face many of the same learning tasks as social bees. For example, acquiring the spatial memory for home and learning the appearance and handling techniques of various flowers. Solitary bees face the additional challenges of being jacks of all trades. While social bees can allocate tasks to groups of specialists, solitary bee mothers must do it all themselves. Locate suitable nesting locations, construct nests, defend them from parasites and predators, and provision the brood. However, I will not attempt comprehensive coverage of the literature on the psychology of these many species of bees. Instead, my focus will be on informative examples from across the world of bees. Roadmap of the book. The book is structured as follows. This introduction is followed by an overview of the bee's sensory toolkit, chapters 2 and 3. This is important because all the information that is stored in a bee's mind must first pass through its sense organs, and we will discover shortly that the sensory world of bees is not only wholly different from that of humans, but also quite possibly richer. However, not everything that is in an animal's, including a human's, mind, is individually acquired. Our instincts govern, at least in part, what we desire, what we fear, how we perform certain movements, and so on. Chapter 4 is about the diverse repertoire of bees' innate behaviors, and the extent to which these govern their psychology and learning behavior. Following this, in Chapter 5, we explore how the roots of bee intelligence can be sought in their lifestyle, as central place foragers, that is, those that have a home to return to. Bees' ancestors had already switched from a vagabond lifestyle to one in which adults built nests, where they protected and provisioned their offspring. And this required a keen spatial memory to ensure that the location of the nest could always be found, even after long-distance excursions. Chapter 6 contains a detailed exploration of how bees' minds represent space. In Chapter 7, we learn how the habit of flower visitation drove bees to be the intellectual giants of the insect world. How, beyond the basic need to learn flower locations, colors, and scents, bees also learn rules and concepts over their lifetime that help them exploit flower resources efficiently. Chapter 8 turns to bee social learning. Bees can learn a surprising amount of information from observing peers, including which flowers to visit, but also how to solve complex object manipulation tasks. Accordingly, many complex social behaviors are much more driven by individual problem-solving than by a diffuse swarm intelligence, as was traditionally thought. Having covered the ground from sensory input to complex social cognition, in Chapter 9, we explore how the miniature nervous system of bees can support such stunning complexity. Chapter 10 focuses on psychological differences between individual bees and their neural underpinnings. In Chapter 11, we draw on evidence from all the preceding chapters and ask perhaps the most difficult question: are bees conscious? Given that the answer is most likely yes, we end in Chapter 12 with ethical considerations relating to bee conservation as they emerge from our explorations of subjective experiences and the likelihood of at least a basic emotional life in bees. A historical framework. Bees, and the sweets they provide, have been with humans right from the beginning of our evolutionary history. Our closest relatives among the apes consume honey and use tools for its extraction from wild bee colonies. It is therefore eminently plausible that the earliest hominins did the same. Prehistoric cave painters on several continents immortalized the raiding of bee colonies, and the members of many extant hunter-gatherer tribes extract honey from multiple species of wild bees. Honey is the most carbohydrate-rich energy drink that nature has to offer, and some scientists now believe that the practice of efficient honey collection might have fueled the evolution of our energy-hungry brains. But as many creative persons will testify, sugar is not all that's required to fuel the generation of bright ideas. And indeed, bees provided for inebriation, too. Mead, made from fermented honey, is one of the oldest alcoholic beverages. Mead has been consumed for at least 9,000 years in countries as far apart as China, Finland, Ethiopia, and pre-Hispanic Mexico. And candles made from beeswax lit up the night, and scholars' desks, and temples, for many millennia before the advent of electric light. Given the long-standing relationship between humans and bees, it is perhaps unsurprising that there is a vast body of scholarly work about the behavior of bees. During research for this book, I have enjoyed browsing the historic literature on the topic, such as the works of the blind Swiss scholar François Huber, who reported, around the turn of the 18th to 19th century, on the possibility that planning abilities were involved in the comb construction of honeybees, as well as on inter-individual personality variation, by which he sought to explain labor division in the colony. Another inspiring story is that of the African-American scientist, Charles Turner, 1867 to 1923, who performed pioneering experiments on the psychology of bees and other insects while working against impossible odds. As a high school teacher, without access to scientific laboratories or libraries. Some of this historical literature is so little known by today's scientists that unearthing it is as exciting as if these discoveries had been made in one's own laboratory. Throughout the book, I have provided a historical context to more recent findings, and we will see that many seemingly contemporary ideas about the minds of bees had already been expressed in some form over a century ago. Since our scientific forebears were often also excellent writers, with styles less dry and jargony than many of today's scholars, I will give you tastes of these historic writings, in the hope that this will inspire you to explore the original works. I have also dedicated space to describing at least some biographical details of the scholars whose breakthroughs have inspired me. This is because no scientist operates in a vacuum. It is often important to understand, for key discoveries as well as important errors, the times and circumstances in which these scientists operated and who influenced them. Come with me on this journey into the minds of bees. We begin with their alien sensory world. 2. Seeing in strange colors. The assumed attractiveness of bright colors to insects would appear to involve the supposition that the color vision of insects is approximately the same as our own. Surely, this is a good deal to take for granted. Lord Rayleigh, 1874. To explore what is in the mind of the bee, we first need to understand its senses, because all the information that an animal ever acquires is first filtered through its sense organs, and these differ profoundly between species. We will learn in this and the following chapter that the sensory world of bees is in no way impoverished compared to ours. Despite their miniature nervous system, bees have all the traditional classes of senses that we do: touch, vision, hearing, smell, taste, temperature, and also some of those that don't spring so readily to mind, such as the senses of equilibrium and of time. They also have senses that we lack, including a magnetic compass. But what is striking is how profoundly different the world of bees is from ours in every possible sensory dimension. We begin in this chapter by exploring the color sense of bees, which, as Lord Rayleigh intuited in the quote, is profoundly different from that of humans. We will use the color vision of bees as a case study in how to explore an animal's senses, before turning, in Chapter 3, to the exploration of bees' other sensory modalities. The first person to experimentally explore the alien color sense of insects was John Lubbock, 1834 to 1913. More of him in Chapter 3. Lubbock observed that if he exposed ant colonies to light, they would move their brood from brighter to darker areas. Then he passed the light through various color filters. He found that the ants would move their brood away from violet light, even though this wavelength appeared almost dark to humans. Lubbock noted, "It would seem that their sensations of color must be very different from those produced upon us. But I was anxious to go beyond this and to attempt to determine how far their limits of vision are the same as ours." He placed the pupae of ant colonies under ultraviolet light, and the workers of various species were quick to remove their larvae from the potentially damaging radiation, wholly invisible to us. Moreover, the ants often shuffled their larvae into red light, which appeared very bright to a human observer, but for the ants seemed close to the complete darkness they were seeking for their brood. This was a first hint, formally confirmed decades later, that many insects are red blind, or at least that their sensitivity does not extend as far into the long wavelengths as ours. The discovery that insects are sensitive to a portion of electromagnetic radiation to which humans are blind opened up a window into sensory worlds entirely different from our own. We know that most animals and all bees can see ultraviolet light. We humans, and most mammals, are quite unusual in missing out on this sensory dimension. The Carl von Hess versus Carl von Frisch debate on bee color vision. Working with individually trained honeybees, John Lubbock demonstrated that bees could learn to associate different colors of paper with honey. However, the German ophthalmologist, Carl von Hess, 1863 to 1923, pointed out that this was not yet a formal proof of color vision. Even a totally colorblind human can distinguish, say, red from blue, since the two are typically different in intensity. Likewise, two differently pigmented papers might appear as different shades of gray to a colorblind animal. In the first comprehensive book on color vision in animals, published in 1912, the eminent von Hess, who had been knighted for his work on the science of vision, concluded that all invertebrates, and also fish, are colorblind. In the same year, an Austrian assistant professor in his mid-20s, Carl von Frisch, 1886 to 1982, made the plausible argument that there would be little sense in colored flowers existing if pollinators couldn't see the colors. Why else would evolution make sure that flowers of most plants stood out in color from their leaves? Von Frisch developed an experimental paradigm that proved von Hess wrong. He gave honeybees a sugar solution reward in a small glass bowl set in a colored rectangular or square card, set in an array of other cards in various shades of gray. The bees invariably located the colored red card among the gray ones, even when the spatial position of the colored card was shuffled, so the bees could not simply have remembered the position of the target. In the German academic system of that time, disagreeing with an established professor could spell the end of a young scientist's career. And as one might predict, von Hess was infuriated. Having caught wind of von Frisch's experiments, he rushed to publish his own account before von Frisch could even get his work into print. Von Hess used honey as a reward in his attempts to train bees to learn colors, rather than the scentless sugar water von Frisch had chosen. But honey has such an attractive scent for bees that it can override any attempt to train them to other target features. Von Hess's results were negative. In his 1913 paper, titled "Experimental Investigations About the Alleged Color Sense of Honeybees," he blustered, "It was possible to demonstrate that the older claims of Lubbock, as well as recent ones of von Frisch, according to which bees can be trained to certain colors, are wrong altogether. Not a single fact is known that could even make plausible the notion of a color sense in bees. Through my investigations, this assumption is terminally refuted." Von Frisch was neither impressed nor intimidated. In his detailed accounts of his experiments, published in 1914, he explained the evidence for the color vision of bees carefully and conclusively. Commenting on von Hess's writings, he did not mince words either. "Of course, von Hess does not admit this. He tries to discredit my work again and again by claiming that it is amateurish and performed without any knowledge of physics or the physiology of colors. No conclusive proof is delivered for these claims. He thinks all my decisive experiments are erroneous. I protest against this polemic approach, and I request that von Hess refrains from using such contemptuous adages." Von Hess presented his bees that he had trained to blue with a yellow pencil sullied with honey and saw that they landed on it. On a blue jacket, they landed only after he had sullied it too with honey. These experiments only show, as everybody knows, that bees can be tempted with honey. As a young scientist, von Frisch had put his future on the line by publishing such statements. He wrote to his mother, "I have the uncomfortable feeling that I now have a real enemy in the world out there, the first one, and someone who could really damage me." But von Frisch's evidence was so overwhelming that von Hesse's attempts to discredit the young scientist failed. In his autobiography, von Frisch would later acknowledge that the altercation had actually strengthened him by giving him wide exposure. It certainly prepared him for defending future discoveries with irrefutable evidence and arguments. Von Frisch went on to win the Nobel Prize in 1973, while von Hesse's views on the topic sank into obscurity. Incidentally, von Hesse was actually correct about bees' unresponsiveness to color in one particular experimental paradigm he had tried, phototaxis, or the attraction to light, which many flying animals display when under threat. It turns out that this behavior is indeed colorblind in bees. But being colorblind in one context does not mean that the organism can't see color. All humans, for example, are colored blind in dim light or darkness. Hence the expression, at night all cats are gray. But both humans and bees see flowers in color, at least during the day. Von Frisch also found further confirmation for the notion that bees' color vision is profoundly different from that of humans. He discovered that while bees had no difficulty locating a blue or yellow square among the gray squares, they would invariably confuse red with the darkest grays. He concluded that bees are red blind, which explains why red flowers are relatively rare in the European flora. Carl von Frisch and the Nazis. Carl von Frisch then turned his attention to other subjects, most notably the exploration of the bee dance language, which we will discuss in Chapter 5. UV sensitivity in a number of bee species and UV reflectance of flowers were discovered in the 1920s. And von Frisch left the in-depth exploration of color vision to his students, most notably Carl Dahmer, in the 1950s. But these further investigations might never have materialized because von Frisch came under attack during the Nazi era, 1933 to 1945. He had a grandmother who, though baptized as a Catholic shortly after birth, had had Jewish parents. The Bavarian State Ministry demanded that von Frisch, a second-degree mongrel, their wording in a letter dated January 12, 1941, be removed from his university post in Munich. Influential colleagues accused him of bigoted opposition towards anti-Semitism, and one of his publications was denounced as a prime example of Jewish propaganda. They lamented that the most modern and best-equipped German zoology institute is currently governed by a small-minded, narrow specialist who is uncomprehending and hostile towards the new epoch. It is high time that the Institute obtains a leadership that terminates these conditions. Perhaps in desperation, von Frisch appears to have gone some way to pander to the Nazis, though he never became a party member. His otherwise insightful 1936 book, You and Life, A Modern Biology for Everybody, contains disturbing final paragraphs on racial hygiene and the recommendation to sterilize mentally retarded people without consent. In these paragraphs, von Frisch himself, so severely nearsighted that he had been deemed unfit for military service in World War I, laments the fact that modern civilization mollycoddles the nearsighted, who would never have survived our primordial ancestors' harsh struggles for survival. One hopes that these passages were added under pressure from Nazi authorities and not volunteered by the man himself, perhaps by going to some length in what was requested by the authorities. Von Frisch hoped to protect not just his own job, but also the multiple Jewish researchers still working at his institute in the mid-1930s. In any case, the text prompts uncomfortable thoughts about how an intellectual, himself at risk from Nazi ideology, tried to navigate those extremely difficult times. In the end, von Frisch's position was temporarily rescued by a honeybee disease outbreak. In 1940 to 1942, Nosema, a single-celled gut parasite, wiped out several hundred thousand beehives, an early colony collapse disorder epidemic, causing significant threats to food security. Many crop plants remained poorly pollinated. Martin Bormann, head of the Nazi Party Chancellery and a close personal friend of Hitler's, directed that von Frisch's dismissal should be postponed to the end of the war. Presuming that the Nazis would win the war and sack von Frisch after the victory, von Frisch took on the thankless task of honeybee disease management until 1945. He was unsuccessful in finding a treatment for Nosema, but the redeployment saved his job and his bee research, and gave him the opportunity to train more young scientists. He went on to make many more groundbreaking discoveries, and most of the scientists whose work is portrayed in this book are his students, or his students' students, or his students' students' students. I'm one of them, but I'm just one of many. A Different Colored World. Karl Dahmer, born 1932, another student of von Frisch, discovered both similarities and differences between human and bee color vision. His PhD work made the bee the best investigated animal for its color vision, besides humans, an eminence the bee has retained ever since, thanks to several generations of talented researchers who followed in his footsteps. Before we explore how bees see colors, a few words about our color perception. Color vision is a little strange, even in humans, in that the perception of color does not easily allow us to reconstruct the physical spectral properties of an object. If we mix yellow with red light, we will see orange. And not only will we be unable to tell that the color has been produced by mixing two lights, we will also be unable to distinguish the mixture from monochromatic, single wavelength, orange light. The perception of white can be generated by mixing any pair of complementary colors, blue and yellow, red and cyan, green and magenta, or the three colors of light that are primary in our visual system, green, red, and blue. By combining the short wavelength and long wavelength ends of the spectrum, violet and red, you generate a perceptual quality that does not exist in the spectrum at all, purple. We are so used to these mixture phenomena that most of us are unaware of how poorly they correspond to the physical world. The physical stimulus, or stimuli, simply cannot be deduced from any single color we see. In contrast, in hearing, you can perfectly well distinguish two tones, or indeed a chord of three tones.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.